Apple sent me the new M4 Pro Mac Mini to check out. And even though my main computer is my iPad Pro, I still like to check in on the Mac every once in a while to see what's going on over there. This video is sponsored by Surfshark. Now, I am a big believer that the Mac Mini is an amazing companion for iPad power users. Even before Apple sent me this Mac Mini, I owned the very base model, just the one you can pick right off the shelf, M2 Mac Mini. Now, this Mac Mini right here has the M4 Pro chip, the 14-core CPU and 20-core GPU option. It has 48 gigs of RAM, 1 terabyte of space, and the 10 gigabit Ethernet port. Total, this is about a $2,300 Mac Mini. Now, before anyone freaks out, this is a review unit. I don't get to keep this. I do have to return it. Now, this thing is an absolute beast. Anything I can throw at it, from video workflows, podcasts, photography, any of my workflows, anything I do, it just chews it up and spits it out. As somebody that completely works from the iPad, what do I even use a Mac Mini for? Well, this all started with Comfort Zone. When we started that podcast last year, we knew we wanted to have a video component. Video podcasts have just gotten bigger and bigger. When figuring out how we wanted to record the video side of the podcast, we looked at a bunch of different services. We also considered recording manually and splicing the different video tracks together. But we found a service called Riverside, and it worked perfectly for our needs. The only catch is it required a Chromium browser, which Chrome, or a Chromium browser, does not run on the iPad in the US. We can get into the whole EU DMA thing. I'm not going to even get into it because there actually isn't even a Chromium browser in the EU right now. I needed a Mac to record Comfort Zone, so that's where it all started. Now, you might also remember I did a video interview with a couple of Apple executives that worked on Math Notes and Smart Scripts after WWDC that year. Now, we recorded in a building that was not soundproofed. It was not set up to cut down on echo or anything like that. So the audio we got from that interview wasn't actually that great. I was recommended an app called Hush. From there, what Hush does is it actually goes in and takes your audio tracks and cleans them up. It'll clean up background noises, room noises, echo, and it does an amazing job. In fact, I am using it for this video right now. But that app only runs on a Mac. So this was another thing that I was using my M2 Mac Mini for. Then fast forward a couple of months, I have always wanted to have proper subtitles for my YouTube videos. The auto-generated ones by YouTube are terrible. My co-host over on Comfort Zone recommended Whisper Transcription to me. This is, again, another Mac app. What this does is you can throw any video or audio file at it, and it will spit out an SRT file, which is a subtitle file that you can upload right to YouTube. And then another task I really wanted was proper automated file transfers. I have a NAS. I've talked about that NAS a lot. So I set up using an app called Hazel. And what Hazel does is you can set it up to watch specific folders. And then when certain criteria hits that folders, it will transfer files, move files, duplicate files. I have a rule set up to back up Comfort Zone episode folders to my archive on my NAS. And then I have another rule that actually sets up a sync between my raw photos folder. So basically, when I take a photo with my camera, that raw photo ends up in a folder. It then syncs that folder with, well, you guessed it, my NAS. There's a lot of automating my file management system with my NAS using Hazel. And again, this is an app that just runs on the Mac. So over the last year or so, I've been hearing and seeing a lot of Mac software and web services that don't run on the iPad. And I've been catching myself saying, I really wish my iPad could do this. But I've been really happy with my iPad as my main machine. It's just the Mac is really growing really fast. I've mentioned I don't like having a bunch of computers. I don't like having to worry about, like, okay, I just changed this app, so now I need to change it on my iPad, iPhone, and a Mac. It's just a lot to deal with. But that has gotten a lot easier over the past few years. But I also came to realize the Mac doesn't need to be the computer where I have my task manager, my note-taking app, my photos library, all that stuff that I interact with personally. The Mac can be a computer that assists me and my iPad, meaning it can handle a lot of background tasks like the Hazel stuff I was talking about, or Hush, where it's cleaning up audio tracks, while the iPad is the computer that I interact with. This video is sponsored by Surfshark. Surfshark is a VPN service that not only protects you, but your data. With Surfshark, your data is completely encrypted from the source, your computer, to its destination. Whether you're working from a public Wi-Fi network, like in a coffee shop or a bar, or you're staying in a hotel, with Surfshark, your data and privacy is secure. Now, this isn't a, well, I have nothing to hide, so I have nothing to lose kind of thing. Data is the new gold, and some scary people will do scary things to get a hold of it. With Surfshark, you can even check to see price discriminations based on region, so you can see what region's paying less for an item you might be ordering. Something I really appreciate about Surfshark is they don't keep logs. VPN services that keep logs are defeating the purpose of using a VPN. You're not getting anything from it. With Surfshark, you can change your location to different regions or countries, so that if you're traveling abroad, you can remote back into your home country and finish that show you were watching, or you can check out another country's Netflix or any other streaming service so that you can see what their catalog might have. I really like Surfshark. In fact, it's a service I started paying for myself years ago, and I haven't looked back. I run it on all my computers. Go to surfshark.com/lolly to get an extra 4 months for free. I'm going to put some links in the description below as well so you can check it out. My thanks to Surfshark for sponsoring this video. Now, my personal Mac Mini, the one I own, is actually mounted underneath this desk that I am sitting at right here. There's no monitor ever hooked up to it. I control it through my iPad using an app called Jump Desktop. Now, I do the same thing with this M4 Pro Mac Mini. I have Jump Desktop running on it, so if I'm out of the house, I can access it if I need be. Or if I'm being completely honest, I'm sitting on the couch and I just don't want to get up. Now, Jump Desktop works really well. It's a really high quality remote desktop application. I can do just about anything I need to with it, dragging files around, putting things into Hush, changing Hazel rules, anything that I might need, whisper transcription, any of that stuff works really well on it. I wouldn't use it to like edit video or podcast or anything like that. There's some lag, but it's not enough for like normal tasks to be annoying. But if you're doing something like video editing, it will get kind of annoying. Now for the M2 Mac Mini, I actually have this HDMI plug that acts as a fake monitor. This lets me adjust the resolution to be precisely what I want it to be and put it in a 4:3 aspect ratio so that it fits my iPad's display perfectly. Now, there are software applications that you can use to adjust the aspect ratio and resolution of your Mac precisely, but I found that this hardware dongle works way more reliably, and it's not that expensive. Now, I did spend a couple of days using this Mac Mini as my main computer. I put the iPad away and I just worked from this Mac Mini. And there are a few things that I walked away from that I was just like, yeah, this is kind of nice. The big thing is flexible third-party applications that can make system-wide changes. This is, again, something that's not possible on the iPad. So for example, my friend Matt, a co-host on Comfort Zone, recommended Supercharge. This is a macOS application that allows you to tweak a ton of different things about the system, like adding cut to Finder so you can cut a file instead of just copying it, or you can add a keyboard shortcut to dismiss all notifications, keyboard shortcut to just toggle Finder or Terminal, all sorts of different things. Speaking of keyboard shortcuts, another app, Keyboard Maestro, for allowing you to create custom keyboard shortcuts that maybe certain applications or the systems don't allow you to do, or tie a bunch of actions together. And then I installed an app called HyperKey, which replaces the caps lock key, which I don't like. I think it's the most useless key ever. It replaces it with a combo of Command Shift Option Control, so those four modifier keys into one key. So that way you can just hit the caps lock key, which becomes your hyper key, and something else, and it won't be stepping on the toes of keyboard shortcuts in other applications. Then there's apps like CleanShot X that give you an incredible amount of control over screenshots and screen recordings, which is something I do a lot of. I really like CleanShot X. It just gives you so much control that the system version of screenshotting, even just the system version on macOS, not just the iPad version, just doesn't give you. Then there's Full Final Cut. I know YouTuber talking about video editing, it gets annoying, but it's what I do. I do a lot of video editing and a lot of photo editing, and having the full versions of these applications is nice. I make Final Cut Pro for the iPad work for me. I can edit all my projects from it. In fact, that's what I do. I work primarily from that. But there are features that are missing that are very limiting. For example, being able to stabilize clips in the timeline, optical flow, object tracking. Those are some nice things that can really elevate my video and make them look just a little bit more professional that I just can't do on the iPad version. But then there's like simple stuff, like being able to copy and paste effects from one clip to another in the timeline using keyboard shortcuts. You don't not having to go through a bunch of menus and manually tap copy and paste every single time. Or just being able to create user-generated presets for effects. Like, for example, in Final Cut, I have my color grade because when I sit down to record a video, it's usually here. So this color grade is constantly the same throughout all my video projects. In Final Cut Pro for the Mac, I can just save that as a preset and just apply it to my timeline. Saves me so much time. That is not an option on the iPad. In fact, I had to create a note in Obsidian with all the effects settings, and I have to sit there and manually type those in every single time I do this on the iPad version. Now, all that being said, I don't like being stuck at a desk. And yes, I know the MacBooks are a thing. I will get to that in just a second. But I like being able to wander around. I do primarily work from home. I primarily am working in here or at my desk that's just outside of this room. But I also like to be able to wander to the couch or to the bedroom or outside or go someplace outside of the house, like to a restaurant or bar or whatever, and just work. So ultimately, I want the flexibility of the iPad. I love the fact that it can be a tablet one moment. It can be at a laptop, it can be a desktop, whatever. Like, I love the flexibility of the iPad, but I also love the power of macOS. Now, I'm not quite at the point of just put macOS on the iPad, but I do feel like iPadOS is holding me back. And the biggest case in point for that is multitasking. The iPad has two systems for multitasking, Split View and Stage Manager, and neither one of them are close to being perfect. What I find fascinating about macOS is it also has multiple systems for multitasking. It just has the regular, you know, you have Windows, but then you have Stage Manager, you have Spaces, the ability to snap windows to the sides. That's all really cool. But on top of all of that, you can install third-party apps that modify multitasking even more, which allows you to customize it even further. And honestly, I think I built a system of multitasking on macOS that, dare I say, is perfect. I love it, for me at least. So first up, I start with building spaces. I have three spaces, a general one, a workspace, and a social space. General is like mail, Safari, calendar, reminders, all that stuff. Work is Obsidian, where I write, where I sit down and get going. Sometimes I'll add another Safari window so I can do research and stuff like that. Then a social space will be like where Ivory, Blue Sky, Messages, Discord, that's where all that lives. But what I was not liking was the fact that applications like Finder, that I want to exist in all of those spaces, were being kind of annoying because they wanted to jump back and forth when you would click the Finder icon, and it just didn't work right. My co-host and friend Neleon recommended to me that if you right-click on any application in the dock, you can go to Options and assign that application to all the space. So that way, I have all of my Finder windows in every single space. This is exactly what I wanted. Then, on top of all of that, I also use full screen applications for stuff like Final Cut and Lightroom and stuff where when I really need to focus and I want all distractions out of the way, the menu bar, the dock, everything else out of the way, full screen apps work great. And you can do the thing like you can on the iPad where you can do split view. You could put two apps side by side if you wish. I didn't necessarily do it that much for me, but having a full screen Final Cut window, even on the studio display, was really nice because I didn't see the dock. I didn't see any like distractions from badges or like, oh, let's go check to see what's on Discord or something like that right now. It was just full screen Final Cut. Everything else was out of the way. Then I would use Mission Control to manage all of the windows. I installed Mission Control Plus originally, but then I actually found out the app that I mentioned previously, Supercharge, does this, where you can actually close Windows right from Mission Control, and you can use shortcuts like Command W or Command Q to close Windows or quit an application. Then the pièce de résistance of this that kind of just highlights everything is I used an application called Better Snap Tool plus Hyperkey in order to manage Windows even quicker. So Better Snap Tool gives you options for snapping Windows to the side. This is a built-in feature in macOS, but it just takes it up a notch. This allows you to assign keyboard shortcuts. So what I did is I used the Hyperkey app that I talked about. So what is caps lock on your keyboard? So it'd be Hyperkey and then the arrow keys. So if I did Hyperkey left, it would take that window, make it 50% of the screen and shove it to the left side. If I did Hyperkey right, 50% of the window size and put it to the right size. So I'd have two windows side by side. But then I could also do like Hyperkey up, which would make a window full screen. Hyperkey down, which would just center a window. It would just make it that 50% screen size, but it would center it right in the middle. This was really nice for just getting windows in positions quickly. I love this. So window management on the Mac is just so much nicer because you can customize things like that. That's not something the iPad can do. And honestly, I don't think it's something the iPad will ever be able to do. But putting window multitasking aside for a minute, multitasking on the iPad is just limited in general. So for example, if you're exporting a video from Final Cut or a bunch of photos from Lightroom or something like that, that app has to stay in the foreground. If you're using Stage Manager, you have to leave that stage open. With the Mac, I can start an export for a video and then go do a bunch of other stuff. I can leave that space. I don't have to like constantly baby it. I can keep going on with my work. And as somebody with ADHD, not breaking that chain, just keep moving forward with your work is really important to me because the minute I stop, it's gonna take me an hour to recover. The iPad has gotten quite a bit better about either like downloading files in Safari or doing file transfers in the Files app in the background. It's gotten better. Like it can do it. But to be honest, that's table stakes. Like that's not really something you should pat yourself on the back for because it's kind of a bare minimum thing. Of all of Apple's platforms, the Mac is the one that's the Wild West. There's still tons of new applications coming out for it all the time. Plus, you're allowed to run apps that aren't just limited to Apple's App Store. You can download apps from the web and run them right on your computer. Wild idea, I know. But this allows you to do things that Apple probably doesn't want you to do. And while they may not want you to do it, at the end of the day, it's still your computer and you should be able to customize it however you want. So where I've landed after this whole experiment, I am not leaving the iPad. The iPad is still my main computer. In fact, I just did a video about how the M4 iPad Pro is my computer. Everything in that video, I stand by still. I talk about the flexibility of the iPad from being a tablet all the way up to a desktop computer. Everything in that video, I still stand by. That is my main computer. That, when I sit down to work, that is where I'm working. But I want to explore the Mac more. Just being able to play around with third-party apps that allow you to customize the system, that was exciting to me. It reminded me of the early days of this channel where the iPad, like working from the iPad was still a really new concept. And I was finding apps and shortcuts, well, they were workflows at the time, that really helped build the idea of working from the iPad. And playing with those kinds of apps again on the Mac reminded me a lot of why I started doing this in the first place. With the Mac Mini as a desktop computer and the iPad Pro as my portable computer, it strikes a nice balance. I can start a video project on my iPad and move it over to the Mac Mini if I want some more power, but if I'm sitting down at my desktop, most of my apps sync, basically everything but Final Cut. So if I'm writing a script, working on a photo, working on a wallpaper pack, something like that, I can pick it right back up on my iPad and vice versa. That flexibility to me is really interesting. Now, when it comes time to send this Mac Mini back, because like I said, it's reviewed and I do have to send it back to Apple. I don't get to keep it. I am probably going to buy a very, very similarly spec'd Mac Mini, probably just a little bit more storage space. I'll replace the M2 Mac Mini that's down here, so I'm recording everything to one machine, but I like this combo here. So that's it. That's how I'm using the Mac Mini in my workflow. If you use both a Mac and an iPad, I want to hear about your workflow. Let me know in the comments below. My thanks to Surfshark for sponsoring this video. If you like the video, hit the thumbs up button, subscribe if you haven't already, and have a great day.